sophisticated technician
right.
for mechanical engineering, specializing in robotics, space technology, and the deputy chairman of the Association of the Observatory in St. Andreasberg, and working at the observatory for 5 years. He always gives public lecture about space technology, as well as space history and special probe mission. So the floor is yours, Matthias.
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. I have two laptops here, and I don't understand everything. Can you please repeat your last sentence?
The floor is yours. You can start the lecture.
Okay. Yes. Can I present my presentation?
Yeah, you can share the screen.
Okay. You can see it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ah, it's clear. Perfect. Okay. So I'm pleased that I can welcome you all here to my little talk about the International Space Station ISS. First of all, my English is not perfect, and such lectures help me to improve my English language skills, especially the correct pronunciation. I think you will hear it. I wrote down what I tell you in the lecture so that there shouldn't be any major communication problems. I hope so.
Okay.
I just have to speak a little more slowly, which I hope doesn't bother anyone. If you have any questions, please give me a little more time to answer them. And as I said, I've only just started brushing up on my expanding my old English skills. And if necessary, my colleague, Mr. Henrik Milner, is also available to offer advice and help. And he will help me with a translation if necessary. Henrik, are you there?
I'm here, and I'm glad to assist.
Ah, that's good. You are the support of my life. Thank you very much. Okay, let's start. As I said before, I would like to tell you something about the ISS, the International Space Station, the largest machine that mankind has built so far. It will be less about the technical details, but rather I would like to show you what a typical daily routine on board the ISS looks like. Here we see the ISS has been looking since 2011. A few weeks ago this year, a Russian laboratory module called Nauka was docked, but essentially, the ISS currently looks like in this picture, what you see here. In order to be able to orientate oneself on the ISS, nautical terms are used. In front here is a bow. In the back is a stern. Here, I have problems with my. The right side is starboard and the left side is port. All information in each case is in the direction of flight. Short note, due to time constraints, I cannot present all the individual modules on the space station here. Therefore, I limit myself to the most important ones. Otherwise, the lecture would take too long. First comes the living and navigation module Zvezda. Zvezda means star in Russian. The module is 13.10 meters long and 4.15 meters in diameter. Zvezda consists of three compartments. The spherical transition part is followed by the cylindrical main part and a likewise cylindrical hermetical seal-able stern section, which serves as an exit lock and storage space. In the middle part, there are control devices, life support, toilet, kitchen, exercise equipment, and two sleeping compartments. The module has four docking units, three passive ones on the spherical transition part at the bow here, and one passive on the stern here. You can see the unmanned progress transporter, all of which have active docking units docked here. We see the active and passive docking devices when we talk about the Soyuz spaceship. This is followed by the storage and function module Zarya. This is the Zarya module. Zarya means red sky at morning. The module is 12.60 meters long and has a diameter of 4.10 meters. Zarya serves as a fuel store and storage room, as well as a place for automatically running experiments. Now we come to the connection node Unity here in the middle, and thus also cross a language border. The space station is divided into an eastern part here and a western part here. In the eastern part, only Russian is spoken. In the western part, only English. The astronaut and cosmonauts on board the ISS must therefore have a good command on both English and Russian. Unity is 5.47 meters long and 4.57 meters in diameter, and it is the first of three connecting nodes of the American part of the International Space Station. On the port side of Unity, here, there is the third connection node, Tranquility. Tranquility is 6.7 meters long and 4.48 meters in diameter. This module contains the most advanced life support system ever flown in space. On the one hand, the wastewater that is used for the crew, drinking water, and oxygen production is treated. Systems for restoring the atmosphere or filtering foreign matter from the air and for controlling the composition of the atmosphere in the module are also included. Finally, Tranquility also provides space for power data, command temperature, and environmental controls. The cupola is under the upper side. You cannot see it on this picture. The cupola viewing platform is mounted at the bottom of Tranquility. We will come to this module later. On the starboard side of Unity here, we can see the Quest airlock. Now we come to the American laboratory module Destiny. You see it here. Destiny is 8.5 meters long and 4.3 meters in diameter. This module experiments in the fields of microgravity, life science, biology, ecology, Earth observation, space science, and technology to run. The second connection node, Harmony, here, is mounted on the bow side of Destiny. The module has systems that supply the station with air, electricity, and water, as well as other vital systems. The pressure side mating adapter forms the end at the bow of the ISS. This was the docking port for the space shuttles, and now it's a docking port for the Dragon capsule from SpaceX. Originally intended as a docking port for the space shuttle, now the Crew Dragon from SpaceX docks at the PMA. The Japanese laboratory module Kibo can be seen on the port side of Harmony. Kibo is the largest single module of the ISS and the first manned space project in Japan. It is 11.20 meters long and 4.40 meters in diameter. We will also come back to the Kibo module a little bit later. Finally, the European Columbus module is located on the starboard side of Harmony. Columbus is 6.87 meters long and 4.47 meters in diameter. The integrated truss structure, ITS, you see here, is mounted at right angle on the flight direction. It is a supporting lattice structure for the space station and particularly forms its backbone. The ITS has 16 solar cell surfaces, 8 pairs of 2 solar cell surfaces each, and a total of 10 radiators. these are the radiators. The solar cells, cell surfaces are used to generate electrical energy and always automatically aligned to the sun, with the help of the heat rejection system, HRS, and photovoltaic radiator, PVR, the excess heat is emitted via radiators. Three row radiators can be found on the central truss elements here and here. In addition, each solar module has a smaller radiator here, 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 and here. the radiators are the thermodynamic counterparts to the solar panels and thus prevent heat built up in the station. The way it works is similar so that a radiator in an apartment which releases the heat generated in the boiler to the outside. The station's robot arm called Canet Arm 2 or Space Station Remote Manipulator System, SSRMS, you can see it here a little bit, here, is also located at the ITS. The arm can move a mass of up 100 tons and is controlled from inside the Destiny module. Four cameras are available for this. Direct eye contact is not necessary. Since the cupola was installed, the SSRMS can also be operated from there. We will see it a little bit later. The arm is not mounted at a fixed point on the station, but can be attached with one of several connectors that are distributed over the entire station. For this purpose, the arm has a gripping mechanism that at both ends. In addition, the arm can be placed on a mobile transporter and driven along the the ladder structure on rails this way. I said that the lecture wouldn't be too technical, but unfortunately we can't avoid a few technical data. You can see the most important technical data on the slide. The space station flies at an altitude between 380 kilometers and 450 kilometers with an average orbit of 400 kilometers. The ISS circled the Earth once in 93 minutes with the astronauts on board experiencing 16 sunrises and sunsets. At this orbit altitude, 400 kilometers, the gravitational pull, of course, still has the same effect as it does here on Earth. The fact that the ISS does not fall back to Earth is thanks to its orbit speed of 28,000 kilometers per hour. At 28,000 kilometers per hour, the ISS flies just so fast that the centrifugal force counteracts with the gravitational pull and prevents it from falling down immediately. In addition, the Earth itself moves on its orbits around the sun. In simple terms, one can say that the Earth is moving away from under the ISS, which is why the space station is in a permanent free fall around the Earth. This means that the astronauts on board the ISS are not in weightlessness, but also in a free fall. You will experience the same effect if, for example, you jump from a high diving platform in a swimming pool. You will experience weightlessness for a brief moment of free fall. However, since there is still a very thin residual atmosphere at this altitude, the ISS is permanently slowed down slightly and sinks around about 100 meters towards the Earth every month. For this reason, the space station has to be raised several times a year. This is mostly done by the docked spaceships or by the ISS itself. The ISS has its own engines to evade approaching space debris, for example. At this moment, the astronauts on board are no longer weightlessness, as the effect of free fall is canceled out during the acceleration phase. When the ISS has reached its maximum operating time in 2028, you can see it here, and there is no further use for the space station, it will be guided into the Earth's atmosphere in a controlled maneuver. Due to its size, the ISS will not burn up completely on re-entry, which is why it is controlled in such a way that the intact parts will fall into the Pacific and sink there. The International Space Station, it is the largest and most durable space station to date. It has been operated and further developed since 1998 in international cooperation between 15 countries and 5 space agencies. You see it here. NASA, Roscosmos, ESA, CSA, Canadian Space Agency, and the Japanese Space Agency, JAXA. It is the largest satellite in Earth orbit and the largest man-made object in space. So now let us see how we get to the space station. You can currently get to the ISS with 2 different spacecrafts, the Russian Soyuz and the American Crew Dragon from SpaceX. In the following, I only decided on the Russian Soyuz, as his spacecraft has been in service for the longest, and the lecture would take too much longer if I presented the Crew Dragon from SpaceX too. But I can do this at a later time in another lecture. So now we see the Soyuz rocket. The Soyuz is one of the most really able launch vehicles currently in use. That is probably also due to the vintage, because the first launch of a Soyuz was on May 18th, 1973. I was born in May 1973 too, and I am also very really able, fun must be. both the launcher and the spacecraft are called Soyuz. So the rocket and the spacecraft is also named Soyuz. When the Soyuz spacecraft has reached its first orbit at an altitude of 150 miles, the actual approach to the space station begins. This approach can take several hours, as the spacecraft has to screw up through several orbits to the ISS. The engines are ignited at certain points on the orbital orbit for a certain period of time so that the Soyuz can reach the next higher orbit. These maneuvers are also known as Hohmann transfers. As we can see, the Soyuz spacecraft is not very big. But that is not a problem either, because it is only used for the flight to and from the ISS. The spacecraft is not built for an independent mission in an orbit like the American space shuttles, which could operate it independently in orbit for up to 14 days. In the middle is the commander seat, who also controls the spacecraft. The pilot sits on his left, the mission specialist on his right. When the cosmonauts are buckled into their seats, it is not possible to operate the switches and buttons on the main control panel, so the cosmonauts have such aids at their disposal to make the necessary things you see here.
Remote control.
Yes. the Soyuz spacecraft consists of 3 modules: the instrument compartment or service module, the desk camp module, and the orbital module. At the back of the vehicle is a service module. It has a pressure-sized container shaped like a bulging can that contains systems for temperature control, electric power supply, long-range radio communications, radio telemetry, and instruments for orientation and control. A non-pressure-sized part of the service module contains the main engine and a liquid-fueled propulsion system for maneuvering in orbit and initiating the descent back to Earth. The spacecraft also has a system of low thrust engines for attitude control attached to the intermediate compartment. Outside the service module are the sensors for the orientation system, are here and here, and the solar array here, which is orientated towards the sun by rotating the spacecraft. The module is 2.26 meters long, and the maximum diameter is 2.72 meters. The landing module, or descent module, here, this part, contains three seats for the cosmonauts, as well as life support control and parachute systems. The module is 2.24 meters long and has a diameter of 2.17 meters. The surface of the landing module is covered with an ablative melting heat shield, which is thrown off after opening the main parachute. The principle of an ablative heat shield is to create a boundary layer between the outer wall of the shield and the extremely hot shock layer gas plasma by slowly burning the heat shield material, generating gaseous reaction products that create a gap between the outer wall and the plasma, thereby reducing the flow of heat wall. The solid fuel brake engines are located under the heat shield and are ignited immediately in the meter range before touchdown. On the surface of the capsule, 24 attitude control thrusters operated with hydrogen peroxide are attached, which control the spatial position of the capsule during atmospheric flight. This makes it possible to use the aerodynamic qualities of the capsule and thus reduce the stress on the cosmonauts. The capsule has a braking parachute, which is opened by auxiliary parachute at the height of about 9 kilometers, and a large main parachute, which deployed at a height of 7.5 kilometers. The braking parachute is ejected at a falling speed of around 864 kilometers per hour. The main parachute at 324 kilometers per hour and breaks the capsule down to 21.6 kilometers per hour. Immediately before landing, 0.70 meters above the ground, the speed of the capsule is reduced to 2 to 4 meters per second with 6 brake rockets. The orbital module is 3 meters long and 2.26 meters in diameter. The module is equipped with a docking connector here, a proximity system. For attitude control, engines are installed in the front part of the module. It's here. Freight goods and other payloads can be accommodated in the pressure size space of the orbital module, and there are also some life support systems, for example, a toilet. We will see the toilet a little bit later. Before takeoff, the cosmonauts enter the spacecraft through a hatch on the side of this module. Sonny, you see it here. No, you cannot see the hatches on the other side. The Soyuz has a small window on the left here and on the right. But due to the round shape of the orbital module, the commander has no view in the direction of flight. For this reason, a periscope, you see it here, a periscope is attached, which projects an image on a small monitor in front of the commander seat, similar to a submarine. With the help of the periscope, the commander can orient himself in the direction of light and carry out the docking maneuver at the ISS. This picture shows a view from the orbital module into the descent module. As already said, the cosmonauts on the platform enter the orbital module through a hatch on the side and then have to descend through another inner hatch into the descent module. The orange ropes here and here, you see, are used to help you descend into the seats. The pilot gets into the capsule first here, then the mission specialist follows, and finally the commander follows in the middle seat here. Technicians help the cosmonauts to get in and by the strap on in their seats. when the three cosmonauts are sitting on their seats, the inner hatch, which connects the deskhead module with the orbital module, will be closed. Only when the spacecraft reaches the orbit, this hatch is open again, and the cosmonauts can unbuckle from their seats. You see, a flight in a Soyuz spacecraft is a cozy affair. Here is an impressive view of the main control panel from the commander seat. Above the control panel, you can see the hatch that connects the deskhead module with the orbital module here. The small monitor that transmits the image from the periscope can be seen below the control panel here. To the left and right of the monitor, here and here, there are two joysticks that are used to control the attitude control and maneuvering engines. Which these joysticks, the pitch, yaw, and roll movements of the spacecraft can be controlled. Even if the Soyuz usually docks automatically, the commander must be able to do the docking by hand if necessary. And this is how the commander sees the space station during the approach. You know, you see here the ISS in the monitor. Speaking of Soyuz, did you know that Russian space travel has a lot of tradition? It's a tradition that all cosmonauts place a carnation on the graves of Yuri Gagarin, the first person in space, and Sergei Korolev, the father of Russian space travel, before takeoff. The graves are in the Kremlin Wall in Moscow. In addition, a tree will be planted in the avenue of the cosmonauts. Incidentally, the American and European astronauts are also referred to as cosmonauts as soon as they fly with a Soyuz spaceship. And one of the most interesting traditions right before the launch is this one. Yes, you see right. The cosmonauts pee on the rear tire of the bus that takes them from their accommodation to the launch pad. This is said to bring good luck. This tradition has been an integral part of the launch since Yuri Gagarin's successful flight. Yuri Gagarin had to pee urgently on the way to the launch pad, and the only option was to open the pressure sweep and then pee beside the bus. Since the flight of Yuri Gagarin was a success, this is nice tradition was taken over by all subsequent missions as a kind of lucky charm. Tradition is everything, and it should also bring luck. Female cosmonauts also adhere to this tradition. However, women do not have to undress in front of the bus. They pee in a glass in the accommodation and then put it out on the tire when the bus stops halfway to the launch pad. Okay, the Soyuz orbits the Earth 32 times before hitting the ISS. Each time it rises a little higher. This process is also known as Hohmann transfer. A direct approach is not possible as the Soyuz would either miss the space station or collide with it. During the 31st orbit around the Earth, the automatic docking system begins to work. It's constantly compared its own location and that of the ISS, as well as the distance to the target. During the 32nd orbit around the Earth, the space station comes into view. This is a picture on the monitor. Now the Soyuz is flying under the space station. By briefly igniting the maneuver thrusters, the Soyuz rises over the ISS. Now the Soyuz lets the space station fly under it and then descends exactly on the flight path of the ISS. Now the final approach to the docking point of the space station follows. About 50 meters in front of the ISS, a guide probe here is deployed from the Soyuz docking mechanism. this guide probe must slide into, you can see it, so, must slide into a funnel-shaped recess at the docking point of the ISS. So you can say the Soyuz is the male and the ISS is a female. It's like a bees and flowers. If the guide probe has slid correctly into the funnel, the ball heat at the probe, you see it here, opens and turns like a screw. If the Soyuz is firmly attached to the ISS, the plugs and supply hoses connect between the two objects. Now a pressure equalization between ISS and Soyuz takes place. This docking maneuver takes up 2 or 3 hours. So, is everything in order? Green control lamps will light up in the ISS and in the Soyuz, and the connection hatch can be opened. You see the docking port of the Soyuz. Here in the picture, the hatch of the ISS has already been opened, and you can see the docking mechanism of the Soyuz. Next, the crew of the Soyuz will also open the hatch, and the way to the space station will be open. Here we see Christina Koch transferring from the Soyuz to the space station. Since the Russian docking lock is very narrow, it is also known as a birth canal. After a successful flight to the space station, we have reached it, and now our 6 months mission begins. But since I don't have 6 months for this lecture, let us just take a look at a daily routine on the space station. Each astronaut is allowed to take a maximum of 1.5 kilograms of personal luggage to the ISS. Clothing is not included. A change of clothes will also be delivered during the mission with a cargo spacecraft. Most often, personal luggage consists of books, CDs, a private laptop, pictures of family, if you need it, and friends or other things that make a long stay more bearable. A satellite phone is available to the crew of the ISS, so they can speak to their families and friends all over the world. The crew can call any number on Earth they want, but no one can call the ISS from Earth. The number is secret, so that no one can call the space station. Of course, the astronauts can also chat with family and friends on their private laptop, but the ISS internet connection is not particularly good. Yeah, yes, really. However, this is due to the fact that important data is constantly being exchanged between the Earth and the space station, and therefore only very little data volume is available for private conversations. At 6 a.m., ground control sends a musical wake-up call to the crew of the ISS. Every astronaut can put together an individual list of music before the start of his mission, which is then sent as a wake-up call. However, since only one wake-up call is sent per day, the music lists change daily so that one astronaut receives his personal wake-up call on one day and another astronaut will get his personal wake-up call on another day. The ground control can also send its own wake-up call music if there are no other requests for the day. The sleeping cabins, here and here, are about the size of a telephone booth and contain not only the sleeping bag, but also the personal things of the astronauts. The most important object in any sleeping cabin is a small fan. Every astronaut checks the function of the fan before he falls asleep. This fan is vital. Everyone breathes out carbon dioxide. If you exhale while sleeping and there is no draft, the exhaled carbon dioxide collects in front of your mouth. At some point, a bubble with carbon dioxide forms in front of your face so that you only inhale carbon dioxide. The result is then poisoning with carbon dioxide. The astronaut no longer wakes up and dies at the poisoning. You can see the fan is vital. Here we see the Italian ESA astronaut Paolo Nespoli, who has made himself comfortable with his sleeping bag in the Harmony connection node. It happened that astronauts prefer to sleep in the passage and not in the narrow sleeping cabins. Everyone as he likes. The position of his arms are typical for sleeping in weightlessness. The arms float slightly above the body when relaxed. Of course, personal hygiene is also a little different than on Earth. The astronauts on board the ISS wash themselves with wet wipes or by moistening half of a towel with a little water and whipping it off with it. The dry half is for dried off. A shampoo is used for washing, which does not foam and can be rubbed out with a towel. A non-foaming toothpaste that can be swallowed is also used to brush your teeth. Karen Newberg will show us how to wash your hair on the ISS. Also note the open blue bag hanging on the wall behind Karen. This bag contains the astronaut's personal hygiene items. So I hope that playing the movie works. Yes. You see the video?
What I like to do is start by just putting some hot water.
Yeah, it's clear, Matthias.
Unfortunately, a little bit quiet.
Sometimes the water gets away from you.
Better?
And you try and catch as much as you can. And then you put the water up through to the end of my
head. Yeah, better.
And I take my no rinse shampoo. You squirt it also on the scalp, just a little bit.
But my voice is loud enough.
And rub it in. Again, kind of working it out to the ends. Sometimes I'll actually take my comb, work it all the way to the ends. And I like to take my towel while I have the shampoo in there and just kind of work it. Because without standing under running water, you kind of need to use the towel a little bit to help get some of the dirt out. I like to follow that by a little more water. It's called no rinse shampoo, but I think it's best to use a little water with it. It actually feels kind of squeaky clean right now. I'll take the dry part of my towel. We use towels for quite a while here, since we have limited supplies. We use them wisely. I think that's pretty good. And now as my hair dries, as the water evaporates from my hair, it will become humidity in the air, and then our air conditioning system will collect that into condensate, and it won't be long, and our water processing system will turn that into drinking water. At the end, I just do one final comb through, make sure there are no snarls and snags, and while it dries, I like to let it stay free. I don't put it back in a ponytail while it's drying. And that is how I wash my hair in space on the International Space Station.
Thank you, Karen, and we will see her a little bit later in another video. So, the morning conference with the ground control take place at 7 a.m. At this conference, all upcoming maintenance work, research work, and interviews will be discussed. Each space agency involved in the ISS has its own ground control. For the Russian part of the space station in Moscow, for the European Columbus Space Laboratory near Munich, and for the American part in Houston, Texas. In the picture, we can see the ISS control room in the Mission Control Center, MCC, in Houston. Here is the workplace of the engineers, technicians, and medical doctors who are responsible for ensuring that operations on the ISS run smoothly. The main responsibility for the operations of the space station rests with the flight director, also called flight. In order to ensure orderly and smooth radio communication with the crew of the ISS, all radio communication is carried out by the so-called CAPCOMs. CAPCOM stands for Capsule Communicator. The CAPCOM must always be a trained astronaut, because only then will he be familiar with the different needs of the astronauts on board the ISS. In addition, the astronauts know each other. Know each other personally, so there is always a trusted person at the radio. Only the respective CAPCOM, the flight director, the place of the flight director is here. Here sits the CAPCOM, and on this side there is the flight doctor. So only the respective CAPCOM, the flight director, and the flight doctor are allowed to speak directly to the crew. All others must first obtain approval from the flight director. Here we see the two NASA astronauts, Stephanie Diana Wilson and Mark Vanderheim. At this point in time, there was an extravehicular activity, EVA. So two CAPCOMs were on duty at the same time. Mark Vanderheim was in charge of the space station, and Stephanie Wilson was in charge of the team that was performing the EVA. Since such EVA maneuver take up to 8 hours, this must be supported by a separate CAPCOM. By the way, Mark Vanderheim is currently on board the ISS. Here we see NASA astronaut Tracy Caldwell Dyson, who also works as CAPCOM. On her computer, she has the daily updated rosters of the astronauts on board the ISS, and so she can see who has to do what at what time. From 9:15 a.m., the work orders scheduled for the day in question will be proceeded one by one. In the picture on the left, the water treatment filter system is currently being serviced. The right picture shows the German ESA astronaut Alexander Gerst, who is currently giving an interview for a children's program on German television. For such official tasks, the astronauts also wear their uniforms. Otherwise, T-shirts and shorts or long pants are worn on the ISS. Here we have an insight into the American laboratory module Destiny. On the left, you can see the control station that controls the robotic arm that is located outside the ISS. Some experiments include their own laptops. You see here. Which are then brought back to Earth by a Soyuz spacecraft or a SpaceX Crew Dragon when the experiment is finished. Here we have an insight into the Russian living and navigation modules Vesta. The Russian modules have a mild green color that is said to have a calming effect on the cosmonauts' mood. The module contains control devices, life support, toilet and shower facilities, the kitchen, exercise equipment, and two sleeping cabins. In the middle of the picture, here, you can see the passage to the docking lock of the Russian unmanned cargo spacecraft of the Progress type. Since the Zvezda module has also small windows, porthole windows, there is also extensive camera equipment for Earth observation in this module. In the right center of the picture, here, you can see the control stand with which the docking of the unmanned Progress spacecraft can be monitored. If there are problems with the automatic docking process, the spacecraft can be remotely controlled from this control station. It is the same as the control panel, including the joysticks in the Soyuz. Two cosmonauts must be present during the remote control docking process, as the individual steps of the docking process are queried via a checklist, basically the same as in the Soyuz spacecraft. Back to the western part of the ISS, we look here at the Harmony connection node. In the center of the picture, you can see the passage here to the Japanese Space Laboratory Kibo. This place is also often used as a hairdressing saloon. A suction device is mounted on the cutter head here, so that hair does not fly through the space station and possibly damage the devices or clog the suction devices. In addition, free floating hair could be inhaled. And the ladies on the space station also treat themselves to a beauty day every now and then. There has to be order also on a space station, a workplace in the Destiny module. Various checklists, pens, timers, flashlights, and laptops. A microphone here can be seen on the left, with which the astronauts can talk to each other on board as well as with the ground control. Given the size of the space station, it can happen that an astronaut walks alone in a module and his colleague work in a more distant module. Internal communication via the onboard radio network is easier than having to shout around. Here we see the microgravity science glove box, MSG, which is in the European Columbus Space Laboratory. In front of the MSG is a microscope. The core element is a large glove box, which makes it possible to carry out experiments under the low gravity, microgravity in a controlled and completely isolated environment. The cupola is a dome-shaped observation tower of the space station. It is located on the Earth-facing side of the Tranquility connection node. The cupola is 1.50 meters high and has a maximum diameter of 2.95 meters. The observation tower has six windows here on the side, as well as a larger 80 centimeter window in the middle, and thus offer an all around view on one direction of observation. The windows can be sealed off, with special shutters to protect them from micrometeorites and space debris. Here, the view from the connecting node into the cupola. And you see here the Earth. Of course, the cupola is not only used to provide a beautiful view of the Earth. This module is also full of technology. Here we see the second upper control station for the robot arm. It is the same one we saw in the Destiny module. But the cupola is also suitable for impressive pictures. In order to shield the interfering light from the connection node, such ceilings are set up where only the astronaut's head can pass through. Then such impressive pictures as the following can be made. Northern Lights with part of the robotic arm in the foreground. A docked Soyuz spacecraft and a part of the Russian laboratory module Nauka and the Earth. And again, the Northern Lights and the starry sky. Very impressive, I think. Okay, we left the cupola and are now in the Japanese Space Laboratory Kibo. Kibo is the largest single module of the ISS and the first manned space project in Japan, as I said. Research focuses on space medicine, biology, and materials research. The most noticeable item in the module is the airlock. Here and here from above. This airlock is not intended for astronauts, but here special containers are loaded onto a platform outside the module with a help of a dedicated robot arm. A special feature is a platform that is attached to the outside of the module, the exposed facility, EF. The platform for experiments is 5.20 meters long, 5 meters wide, and 3.80 meters high. Individual experiment containers can be attached around the platform. You see it here. So far, I have not been able to find details about the experiments, but most of them are likely to be experiments in the field of research into solar wind radiation and particle distribution. The individual containers are lifted out of the airlock with the help of their own robotic arm and then attached to or on the platform. I think now it is time for some exercise. Every astronaut on the space station has to do up to 2 hours of exercise a day so that no bone or muscle mass can regress. A stationary bicycle, a weight bench, and a treadmill are available to the astronauts for this purpose. Karen Newberg, we already know her, will now explain how the treadmill works. During the training session on the treadmill, the astronauts can listen to music or watch a movie on the laptop.
Hi, welcome to the International Space Station. As all of my family and friends know, I love to run when I'm on Earth. Luckily, we have the capability to run here on the space station. In fact, it's one of the three exercises that we do on a daily basis to help keep our hearts and our bones and our muscles strong while we're here without the gravity pull of Earth affecting our body every single day. So let me show you how we do it here.
Can you try increasing the volume a little bit? A little louder?
It's located in Node 3 on the International Space Station. Notice.
Bisschen lauter.
Bisschen zu laut?
Nee, lauter.
And the reason is because there are a lot of loads when you run on a treadmill, and you really don't want to impart those loads onto the space station. So we have all of our exercise equipment on a vibration isolation system. Obviously, in space, we need something to keep us on the ground when we're running. What we use is a harness, which is very much like a backpacking harness, and the straps are adjusted so that the load is equally distributed between your shoulders and your hips, just as if you were backpacking. We attach by these rings the harness to a system of hooks and bungee cords. You can see there's some stretch in the bungee cord. Then you can adjust and change the number of hooks that we use. Today I'm going to use 4 hooks. If I were to use 3 hooks, it would provide a little more load. If I use 5 hooks, it would be a little less load. And then in that way, we can adjust the amount of load on our body as we're running. The T2 is controlled by our laptop here in front of the treadmill. And then once I'm all strapped in, I can go ahead and select a protocol. Our trainers on the ground get protocols assigned for us that we can use. Interval protocol that I can do. And now you can see that there's a target load. The target that my trainers wanted me to reach was 100-pound load. There are load cells in the treadmill, and that's how it's determining. And you can see with the 4 hooks that I put on, it's pretty close to what the target load is. Click OK, and then I'm ready to run. See, we also have heart rate on display. We wear heart rate monitors. This when once I push start, the federal belt will start moving, and I'll just follow the protocol. That was a great run. Not quite the same as being out in the fresh air. Wind in your face. But a nice little trip.
Okay. In order to check whether an astronaut has lost or gained body mass, the astronaut must be weighed. For this, the astronaut, here we see Alexander Gerst again, has to lie on this spring mechanism. This mechanism makes the body vibrate and the vibrations pass through the human body. Using the period of oscillation, it can now be calculated whether the body has increased or decreased mass. Another very important topic of the space station is, of course, the occurrence of fires. There are a variety of electrical systems, computers, and cable connections on the ISS. In addition, there are flammable gases and liquids. But what should you do if a fire actually does occur? In this picture, taken during a training session at the training center in Houston, we see the two astronauts, Christina Koch here and Jessica Meir here. Both want to put out a possible fire in one of the experiment racks here. The International Standard Payload Rack, ISPR here, REC for short, is a standard research module in the laboratories on the ISS. Each REC has a special connections. You see it here, and here, and here, where a small fire extinguisher, here, this, with carbon dioxide can be connected. This prevents other areas from being affected as a result of the extinguishing work. Since the fire extinguisher is not firmly connected to the connection, Christina would immediately fly through the space station when the extinguisher was activated. In the weightlessness state, the carbon dioxide emitted would function like a cold gas thruster. Therefore, Jessica first has to wedge herself behind Christina and give her the necessary support. If the fire has already become too big, then all that remains it is to evacuate the space station. Another important area on the space station is medical care. Of course, the astronauts are permanently monitored by flight doctors, but they are in the MCC, or in the Mission Control Center, and cannot intervene directly in the event of a medical emergency. It is therefore necessary for the astronauts to be able to provide effective help themselves in the event of a medical emergency. Since the astronauts come from a wide range of professions, there is usually at least one doctor on board. In addition, the astronauts are trained as emergency medical technicians, the standard of the American paramedics. The medical equipment of the space station is similar to that an ambulance, and smaller operations can also be carried out, for example, sewing wounds or even dental treatment. In the event of a serious emergency, the astronaut in question and two others would be immediately brought back to Earth in a Soyuz. Nevertheless, body bags are also part of the medical equipment of the ISS. Fortunately, such an emergency has not yet occurred. In the picture, we see Serena is another astronaut here and here. She is also a flight doctor, giving Alexander Gerst a cardiopulmonary resuscitation, of course, only for exercise, CPR. It should be noted that she must also be clamped with her feet. You see it? With her feet, otherwise she would float through the station on the first attempt at pressure. Since the visual performance can be impaired under the weightlessness, the eyes must be checked regularly. Here we see Christina Koch with a blackboard that everyone probably knows from an optician. So that the board always has a sign distance from her eyes, she has a small stick in her hand as a spacer. But enough of the medical stuff. Let's go outside a little so that we can get some fresh air again. We want to leave the space station and go into the airlock, which is in the quest module. But stop. Before we finally get outside, we have to keep a few things in mind. Otherwise, it will only be a short trip for us and our last two. A few hours before we get out, we have to breathe in pure oxygen through a bracing mask so that the nitrogen is displaced from our blood circulation. This is important because there is a slight overpressure in the space suite, and otherwise so-called diving disease can occur. The space suite is a gas-tight protective suite that secures vital functions, especially breathing, in the vacuum of space by putting itself under positive pressure. An oxygen device attached to or built into the suite removes the exhaled carbon dioxide and replaces it with oxygen. Such an EVA suite weighs around 140 kilograms, is basically like a small one-man spacecraft with which the astronaut can stay in space for up to 8 hours. Here we see the inside of the Quest module. This module serves as an airlock for outboard work and can be used with both American and Russian space suites. Quest is 5.5 meters long and has a maximum diameter of 4 meters. Quest consists of two sections. In the first, larger device section, equipment lock, the astronauts prepare for their exit, put on their space suits, and test their correct function. After the end of the EVA, maintenance work on the suites will also be carried out here. This includes charging the batteries and refilling the oxygen tanks. The second, slimmer section, crew lock, this is what we see here, is the actual airlock. Before the outer hatch is opened, this is the outer hatch, the air is evacuated into a tank using special vacuum pumps. There are two large oxygen and two nitrogen tanks on the outside of the airlock. The module also has platforms and brackets, as well as power and communication connections. An EVA like this is always a special thing for every astronaut because not everyone has the opportunity to work freely in space. Here we see Christina Koch again, just leaving the airlock. You can see a small book on her left hand wrist. These are small cards on which the necessary process steps for the upcoming EVA are written. There is a small mirror here on the back of her left hand. This enables her to regulate the settings on her control device, heating, cooling, oxygen supply. Due to the helmet, she cannot see the switches and displays and therefore has to use this mirror. In addition, with the help of the mirror, she can see backwards without having to turn around completely when she makes so. In her helmet, she has a small tube with which she can drink water. But the most important thing in this helm is a small strip of Velcro. Yes, Velcro. What do you do when your nose itches? Right, you can scratch your nose. But Christina cannot do that because she has a helmet on that she cannot take off for up to 8 hours. Therefore, the astronauts scratch their nose on the rough side of the Velcro strip. This is space innovation. Below the survival unit that Christina carries on her back, we can see the SAFER, Simplified Aid for EVA Rescue. This is this, you see? SAFER is a small backpack system for EVAs and is designed as a self-help system with which the astronaut can maneuver back to the spacecraft or to the space station if the safety line should break and no outside help is nearby. Safer is attached to the EMU backpack. EMU stands for Extravehicular Mobility Unit. This is a space suite on the astronaut's back, which contains the life support system. The rescue unit has 24 small cold gas thrusters that run on nitrogen. It's bright now. No. You can stay seated. It's break on the space station. We are not taking a break, but the astronauts on the space station are now taking their lunch break. A good opportunity to see what you can eat and drink on the ISS. So follow me into the Unity module to the kitchen. Just like on Earth, a clean table makes eating more comfortable. Every astronaut has his own cutlery, scissors, knife, fork, and spoon. You see it here on the board. There are strips of Velcro tape everywhere on the table and in the space station so that the individual objects are securely attached and cannot simply float away. About a year before the start of the space station or to the space station, each astronaut can choose his own individual meal, which is then taken into account in his personal menu. The food is prepared on Earth, then made anhydrous and packed airtight. The astronauts are also happy to exchange their food with each other or to prepare a meal together. We will see it in a moment. Spicy sauces are particularly popular as the sense of taste change in weightlessness and things taste differently than on Earth. Here is a brief overview of the wide range of food and drinks on the ISS. It all looks very sterile, but that's just the packaging. The content is nothing else than what we eat on Earth. So there is no longer any comparison to the tube meals from the Gemini and Apollo time. At the top right, we see spinach. If you look closely, you can see the connector in the corner, which connects the bag with an apparatus that gives warm water to the anhydrous spinach. Then the contents of the bag have to be kneaded a little. Now just cut it open and the spinach can be eaten. In the lower left corner is a bag with beef stick in it. You see beef stick. And we see biscuits, small cakes, and candy-coated peanuts. Here we see, among other things, a bag with orange juice, but also a bag with cheddar cheese. And here, beefsteak again, cashews, spinach. Here we see, the staple food of all astronauts and mine too, coffee. In this case, it is milk coffee with sugar. Without enough coffee, nothing works in the space station either. But that is also possible in the ISS. Fresh vegetables, in this case salad, have been grown in-house since a few years.
Excuse me, Matt. You have just 15 minutes to complete the presentation.
I think it's nine slides. I think 15 minutes is okay.
Okay, fine.
It is also important for personal well-being that the crew can eat fresh vegetables as often as possible and not always only freeze-dried ones. Fresh food and vegetables are also delivered with the cargo spacecrafts, but since the ISS has no way of refrigerating such food for a long time, such food is eaten in a short time. Don't forget that shipping a kilogram into space costs around $10,000 to $25,000. In the cargo spacecraft, there are always a little surprises for the crew. In this case, ice cream. You see ice cream Magnum or Snickers. Since there is no way to make ice cream on the ISS, this was, of course, a particularly nice surprise. And here we have another device on the ISS, which has improved the mood. Well, who knows what it is? Right, it's a pizza oven. No, there is also an Italian flair at meals on the space station. I think the joy on their faces says it all. The finished blanks are created with ketchup or another sauce and then top it according to personal taste, with cheese, with sausage, with peppers, with olives, with mushrooms, and so on. another piece of normality in an unusual workplace. The Italian ESA astronaut Paolo Nespoli brought the very first pizza oven back then a suitcase to the ISS. In the following film, we see for the first time where pizza was baked on the space station. And take a closer look, since it is not so easy to cut with a knife in weightlessness, the pizza is divided with scissors. Okay, we are now almost at the end of this lecture, and therefore no follows what also comes on Earth after the meal. The disposal of the final state of the food. Oh, Henrik, du weißt, was kommt. in an Apollo spacecraft, doing physical needs was still a lot of work. But since only men belonged to the crew, these were not really a big problem. After all, they already knew each other. Here we see the things you needed to pee on board an Apollo spacecraft. If you had to pee, you had to roll a condom over your front docking point. The other end of the condom was connected to a tube with a valve on it. When the valve was operated, the urine was released directly into space. The urine first flowed into a collecting container, which was then emptied into space when needed. But that led a problem that was only noticed with Apollo 8. Apollo 8 was the first mission to go to the moon, and it was correspondingly long journey. If a liquid is dispensed on one side of a spacecraft, then we have the principle of a cold gas thruster. This means that with every urine drain, the Apollo spacecraft deviated very, very slightly from the actual flight path, and this then had to be corrected. These condoms came in three sizes: small, middle or normal, and big. But since every Apollo astronaut wanted to brag about his qualities in front of his colleagues, everyone took the size big. What led to the problem that the condoms did not always fit. The desire is something stronger than the reality. The problem was solved in a very elegant and humorous way. The size of the condoms was renamed, and from now on, there were only sizes big, very big, and gigantic. This disposal for the other final state of the food was really real teamwork. An astronaut had to stick a bag with tape, the tape was integrated into the bag, to his colleague's butt. Since things do not separate in the weightlessness as one is used to on Earth, the necessary separation of body and final state of food had to be carried out by means of manual intervention. The bag has a special opening for the hand. You see it here. things were much more comfortable in the space shuttle. Here we see the toilet of a space shuttle. At the front of the toilet is a tube that is responsible for collecting the urine. If necessary, a kind of funnel only needs to be attached off the front. When the valve is activated, a slight negative pressure is created and the urine is sucked off. The funnels are ergonomically shaped depending on whether is the astronaut is a male or female. The urine was then turned back into drinking water. For the other exit of the body, you had to sit on the toilet, just like on Earth. It was very, very important that the butt was absolutely correct over the opening so that unwanted objects wouldn't float through the spacecraft. So there was a small camera in the toilet and a small monitor in front of the toilet, the so-called S-centering monitor. Now the correct sitting of the butt on the toilet could be checked. The camera then pans away and nature could take his course. Since the flight in a Soyuz doesn't take that long, you don't need a large toilet. I think the picture is self-explanatory. Above is the device for women and below is for men. The small back is intended for the part of the device that covers the butt and holds its end products. And this is what the two toilets on the ISS look like. Left is a toilet in the Russian part of the space station, right in the American part. The functionality is similar to that of the space shuttle, only that there is no longer a camera. Also at the space station, the urine is made into drinking water again. Water is a vital commodity. At 7 p.m., there is another conference with the ground control, and then it's quitting time. After a joint dinner, the astronauts begin their free time, and they can do their own thing, or, as shown in the picture, watch a film together. If you look closely, you will see that it's a Star Wars film. At night, when there is no operation on the space station, the light is switched off so that only the green lights of the displays from the machines illuminate the interior of the modules. Very impressive, I think. And with these two atmospheric pictures, our little excursion to the International Space Station ends. I hope you had some fun, even it has certainly given now and then problems with my English pronunciation. I'm sorry for that. Yeah, I'm not an astronomer, I'm a space technician. My heart beats for space travel, for rockets, space vehicles and space stations. And yes, I'm absolutely certain that in the future, it will also be possible to travel to other solar systems. It will be a long way there, no question, but it will be possible, I think. Success will also depend on how we go down this path, each nation for itself or all together. I think such future projects can only be mastered by all nations together. Not only astronomy connects people around the world, we see it here at this lecture, space travel can also bring people together for a common future. As the Russian space pioneer Konstantin Tsiolkovsky said, the Earth is a cradle of humanity, but we cannot stay in the cradle forever. The solar system will be our kindergarten. So I think the universe is waiting for us. Thank you for your patience and attention.
Yeah, that's true. Thank you, Matthias, for this very interesting and informative presentation. Now we are going to the question part. So please feel free to ask any question in the chat or directly. You can use raise hand via reaction down here in the Zoom application, and I will unmute your microphone.
For me, I think a chat is a little bit better because when I chat, then I can use my translator.
We will not.
Or my colleague Henrik must support me a little bit. Then we can talk.
Okay. I will start with the social media questions from our audience on Facebook and on YouTube. So the first question is how it was built, the ES, the International Space Station, and it is a cooperation project.
The International Space Station was built from, I can show you the picture, was the start of construction was 1998, and it was always a connection between 15 countries, because it's the costs are too much for one nation or for two nations. So it was the first big project where different countries work together.
Yeah. So I'll move on directly to the next question. Which criteria the space agency select to send astronaut to the ESS?
Henrik?
Wie werden die Astronauten ausgesucht? How are they elected for space travel?
Ah, okay. If you like to be an astronaut, it is good when you have a profession in science or in mechanical engineering, or maybe you can be a fighter pilot. And not every astronaut must be a doctor. But it is very good when you have Henrik, was heißt bewerben?
Apply.
Was?
Before you apply.
Before you apply, you have some science work, and you must be. Yeah, but it's. I think there are no so a lot of special things you need to be an astronaut. You must be healthy. That is clear. You must speak very well English. You see, I'm not a good astronaut. You must speak very well Russian. But it's not important how old are you. You can be 25, 35, 45. That is not important. And at this time, the ESA, the European Space Agency, is looking for astronauts. And I think if you would like to be an astronaut, you can try it.
Thank you. Okay, the question, how astronauts fly the ESS and how long they could stay?
When they fly to the ISS with Soyuz, it's need 24 or 48 hours. It is important where the ISS is when the Soyuz spacecraft starts from Earth. So, but you can say between 24 or to 48 hours. It is possible to fly to the ISS a little bit faster, but this is not nicht die Regel. Was heißt denn das?
Not the usual way. I think it's more expensive as well.
It's not the usual way. Roundabout, you can say the trip from Earth to the ISS is 24 hours.
So it depends on the location of the ISS and the money, of course.
was jetzt ein Flug kostet, oder?
It depends on the money, how fast you can get there. If you want to spend more money on fuel, wenn du mehr Geld ausgibst für Treibstoff, you can go faster.
Yes, but the problem is you need, when you go faster, the problem is you cannot fly directly to the ISS, because then you then it's a maybe you can collide with the ISS. You must do some different orbits and screw up the spacecraft to the ISS, because it is not possible. This is yes, this is orbit dynamics. It's not possible. It is not only the money when you need more fuel. It is from the different velocity not possible.
So Ahmed Khalil here in the chat say amazing lecture about ISS, and he asked a question about does have internet service in ISS from Iraq Baghdad?
Henrik?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
I think he mean if in the ISS have they have internet service.
Yes. Do you remember the two astronauts, Christina Koch and Jessica Meir? And the time with Jessica Meir on the space station was there was in the first astronaut from Iraq, I think. Yes. And at this time, there will be the first female astronaut from the Arabic Emirate will train in the in the training center in Houston, Texas, and she will be the first woman in space and on board the ISS from the Arabic Emirates.
Mm-hmm. So I'll move on to the next question. How astronauts conserve their foods?
Conserve?
You mean like in a fridge? They are, I guess, dehydrated, and that should keep them fresh. So, wie man sie erhält, dass sie nicht vergammeln.
The food is dehydrated, and then he is air free on Earth in the package. So there is no refrigerator aboard the ISS for food. They have a refrigerator, but this is only for experiments, not for food. So the food is when you buy coffee. It is in this, it is, was heißt luftdicht?
Sealed, vacuum sealed.
Yes, vacuum. It is vacuumed. And so it is for a long time possible that you can lager?
Store.
That you store it. But every astronaut stay for 6 months on the ISS when he begin his expedition. Then he have some parts of his food, and in the six months there come one or two unmanned cargo ships, and they bring more food to the ISS. So every astronaut must not have his complete food for the 6 months at the start when he start his mission. So he will get some food in the time in his mission time.
It's interesting. And we buy some food that astronauts eat. Don't quite interesting this question. She say, can we buy some foods that astronauts eat?
Yeah. You mean if we can buy this astronaut food on Earth?
Yeah.
I think you can buy, for example, space ice cream called, but you Don't forget the astronauts eat the same food like we eat on Earth. For example, the Italian ESA astronaut Samantha Cristoforetti, 1.5 years before her mission start, she go to her favorite Italian restaurant, talk with the cook, and they both together make a special menu list, and then he cooks the food for her, and it was dehydrated, and then it sent it to space. So it is the same food like you eat on Earth. You remember the picture with the snacks, with the ice. It was Magnum ice and Snickers. So I think when you have some companies who sell special astronaut food, it is the same food you can buy on Earth in a supermarket, but it's much expensive.
So Rebel asked what happened to the fire alarm that the ESS astronauts hear it in the 9th of September?
Yes, I hear it today before 1 hour before my lecture starts, so that I cannot talk about it in my lecture because it was finished. Yes, it's a problem. I think it was this fire was in one of the Russian modules, and in the news they said it smell a little bit like plastic. So I think it was not a big fire. It was a fire in the electricity, and I have no more or no new informations, but I think they will have a success fight the fire, and the station must not be evacuated.
Mm-hmm. So I move on to another question. How hard the life it is inside the ESS from scale of 1 to 10?
Wie schwer ist das Leben auf einer Skala von 1 bis 10?
On the space station. I think it's when 1 is simple and 10 is heavy. I think it's 5 or 6. It's a little bit heavier than on Earth because some things you can do on Earth you cannot do on the space station. But I think the hardest thing is when you come back to Earth after 6 months, because when you're 6 months on the space station, you are in the weightlessness, and you have to do no work when you raise your arms, when you raise your legs, and when you come back to Earth, it is from one moment to another moment. You must do a lot of heavy work when you move your arms, raise your arms, and I think when you are back on Earth, this is much, much heavier. I think the first time when you're back on Earth, it will be 9 or 10 for the first week.
So I personally have a question. Okay, Martin, raise your hand. I will unmute you. You can ask your question, Martin.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
So also my camera is on. I have a question about the starting place. You said the flights come from the Russian, Roscosmos starts at somewhere in Russia. I forgot the name of the place. And of course, the Americans would start at Cape Canaveral, but the ESA has Kourou in French Guiana, or I don't know how to pronounce this correctly. This is much closer to the equator, and I think from the, wie sagt man, Breitengrad, the distance, altitude,
latitude
difference from equator is it needs less energy for the rocket to start to space. Why don't they start from Kourou? It's just too expensive to transport the Russian Progress or whatever to there, or is this another reason?
Also, the Russia the Russian spacecraft starts in Kazakhstan, or it's not Russia state, it's Kazakhstan, and yes, the other are on the American East Coast in Houston and in Kourou, Französisch Guayana. But the problem is the ESA has no manned space travel in Kourou, only starts unmanned space missions. But in Kourou, there is a special launch platform for the Russian Progress cargo ships. So sometimes the Russian cargo ship starts from Kourou in Französisch Guayana.
Ah, yeah.
But the ESA have no manned space missions.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that they start from there. Okay, fine.
Okay.
So, if there is any other questions from our audience, so please feel free to ask.
It is not a problem for me when someone write me a message on Facebook, so I can answer a little bit later.
Mm-hmm. No problem. Mm-hmm. I personally have a question. I wonder how much the space weather, for example, the last sun activities, or the geomagnetic storm could damage the ESS. International Space Station.
Schaden durch Sonnenwind?
Yes, the solar arrays must be changed after a different time, because solar wind I was a little bit wrong. You mean solar wind, not micrometeorites, right? Also, Henrik, hilf mir mal. War jetzt Sonnenwind oder Meteorite?
Do you mean both, also meteorites, or just the solar emissions?
Space weather, and it can be the solar emission also.
Beides.
Okay. When you are inside the ISS, there is no problem, because the modules are safe for micrometeorites or for particles from the solar wind. But the space suites are a little bit safe, but not so safe like the ISS. So the solar wind is not the problem. But micrometeorites, this is a problem.
If the astronaut in the suit is hit by micrometeorites.
Yes, it's hit by micrometeorites, and there is a hole in his space suit, but not more than a half centimeter, 0.5 centimeters. Then he have maximum 30, 40 seconds. In this time, he must arrive the airlock, and then when he can go into the airlock, then he is safe. But when the time is too long, he had no chance. Because the pressure from the spacesuit will lost, and then he is dead. Because this is a very dangerous for an astronaut to work outside the space station. So NASA have a special experiment with a robot called RoboNaut. In the future, such robonauts will do the work outside the space station. But at this moment, it is usually notwendig.
Necessary work.
It's necessary, yes. It is necessary that humans do the work outside the space station. It's dangerous, yes, you are right. This is very dangerous for every astronaut who works outside the space station.
Okay. But, I guess that the question intended also the space weather means that from sun there is coming a lot of charged particles, charged ion, hydrogen, helium ions, which can destroy all the electronics. We read that when there is a solar storm, burst, then satellites can become defective, and then they have time to switch off? Would they switch off electronics not necessary, or turn the solar panels about the axis? And
No, I understand. I'm so sorry. No, I understand. No, you have right. This is no way. When a solar wind comes, the ISS has no chance to go to a safety part of the orbit. This is dangerous, yes. So this is a problem what the astronauts have.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm sorry that I don't understand it right before, sorry.
No, it's okay. So if there are any other questions from our audience?
Yeah, I have a very stupid one. So the ESS, if we can buy like Sentry Gauss, it was the idea of who bring that idea to send a space station outside of our planet?
First of all, there is no stupid question. There are only stupid answers, like me now. But there are no stupid questions. Henrik, was war jetzt die Frage?
Wer auf die Idee gekommen ist, eine Raumstation außerhalb der Erdorbit zu errichten?
Yeah, the first idea for a space station came from the German rocket scientist Wernher von Braun, the man who brings the American astronauts to and on the moon. And his first idea was to make a big wheel in the sky, and a big wheel. And so the wheel are rotated, so you have a gravity on the station. And from this station, you are can fly to other planets. So this was his idea. And then came the first space stations from the Russia, because the first Russia space station, the Almaz stations, was a military station at the beginning from the 1970 years. And the American made her first space station, the Skylab laboratory. And the next step is to build a space station in an orbit around the moon. And then we can fly with rockets to the space station, which fly on the moon. And from this space station, from the moon station, we can explore the moon. And we can fly to Mars, because when we start our spaceship for the journey to Mars, we don't need so much energy and fuel as we start from Earth. But the idea for a space station is very old. I think Wernher von Braun had the idea in the 1960 years to build a space station. Was is the correct answer of your question?
Yeah, it was. Don't worry. And don't say that your answer is stupid. There are no answer. There is stupid question and no stupid answer. So don't say that.
No, I mean there's science no
change. Open mind and just discuss. That's the real science, is to exchange, not to say stupid answer or question. Your answer and your previous answer, it was not stupid at all. So just take it smoothly.
Thank you very much.
Well, if there is no other question, so we're gonna end the session.
Yes.
And thank you everyone for your participation. And thank you, Matthias, for this lecture. Thank you, Sean.
I must say thank you for your patience and attention, because I know I was terrible. My English was terrible. I know.
It was good.
I will improve it.
So bye and thank you.
Bye and thank you.
Thank you.
Gute Nacht.
Gute Nacht.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night and have a nice Sunday.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.